serving America's great sports networks. You're watching Prime Network.
Presents the 1993 Bud Light LPBT Spring Tour. Tonight, the Alexandria Louisiana Open. Welcome to the Four Seasons Bowl here in Alexandria. Hello, everyone. I'm Leandra Riley. And so far this spring, we've seen four different places, and we're going to see four different faces except the top paycheck. That's because tonight, none of our three previous television winners have qualified for the stepladder finals. So what's happening on the LPBT this spring? Well, let's ask a very familiar face, our own Leila Wagner. Has parity reached the LPBT this spring?
Well, Leandra, it seems that way. The competition this week has been extremely tough, as it has been all year. This spring, though, we've seen the left-handers dominate the first 2 weeks. This week, it was more the down-and-in players that dominated, with the exception of Leanne Barrette, who hooks the ball.
All right, let's talk about our number one seed. She's a lady who likes to go by her first name only. That would have to be our own Patty Ann.
Well, Patty Ann joined the professional ranks back in 79. She did win a title in 1982, but then she gave up her professional status and she turned amateur. In 1989, she was AMF World Cup champion. In 1990, she was Amateur Bowler of the Year. This lady is no stranger to the winner's circle.
Well, she's sitting on top, but there are some tough challengers beneath her. In the number two position, it's Lisa Wagner, and she was a bowler of the decade in the 1980s.
Well, she's making her comeback in 1993. She does have one title. Lisa Wagner is the winningest pro bowler of all time with 27 titles. She is back in rare form, and she is going to be one tough competitor here tonight.
In the number three position, it's Kim Couture.
Well, Kim Couture was the 1991 Rookie of the Year. This lady has been flirting with the Telecast this year in two other occasions. She has finished sixth. Last night, she was sixth going into the final round. She said, "I don't want to finish sixth." She won eight of her matches, averaged 233 to secure that number three spot.
And the worst she can do then is fourth, but hopefully we'll think positive for Kim Couture this evening. But she's going to have a wait-and-see attitude because our first match features Leanne Barrette against Debbie McMullen. It's the Alexandria Louisiana Open when we come back. Stay with us.
We all need. So when you go bowling, make sure you ask to compete in an ABC-sanctioned league or tournament. It's your assurance that you really are a bowler and not just going bowling. Let's go bowling with ABC.
The Bud Light LPBT Spring Tour is brought to you by Bud Light. If you want great taste that won't fill you up and never lets you down, make it a Bud Light. And by Brunswick, home of the winningest pro on tour, the Brunswick Rhino Pro. And we are back at the Four Seasons Bowl here in Alexandria, Louisiana. And it's Leanne Barrette against Debbie McMullen on lanes 13 and 14. And Leanne Barrette is up first on number 13.
Leanne Barrette is trying to break back into that winner's circle. She has not won a title since October of 92 when she won the Eastern Hammer Open in Baltimore.
Now, Leanne did have a 300 game this week. And in winning that 300 game, or I should say in bowling that 300 game, she was eligible to win a brand new car. Unfortunately for her, somebody else bowled a 300 game, and that was Patty Ann. So the two of them had a roll-off for it. You'll have to stay tuned to find the results. I'm not going to tell you who won the car.
You're going to leave them in suspense.
I'm going to leave you in suspense. Who got the new car?
And a beautiful car it is.
Now you're looking at Debbie McMullen of Denver, Colorado. And she's made all nine stops of the LPBT, the Winter and Spring Tour. She's been in the top 24 six times. Oh, and opens things up for the strike.
Carrying the light wall shot. Debbie McMullen has been on tour 4 years. She is not been able to capture a title yet. This is only her fourth television appearance. First time this year. She's trying to break the jinx. Her last appearance came in 1992 in the Delaware Open. She happened to defeat Jan Schmidt, but then she went on to lose to Dede Davidson. With each time you appear, I know the nerves start to go away and you start to feel more and more relaxed, and you learn by your previous appearances. Not liking that shot, also not liking the feel of the ball. The lanes appear to be playing a little bit tighter on the outside than they have been throughout the week. I had mentioned in the Open the players that went more down and in, straight up to the pocket, not so much of a hook ball, actually played very well this week. It seemed to be the better type of a line for carry. Scores were high.
And she converts the spare in her second frame, and Leanne Barrette steps back up as Debbie McMullen's head is spinning.
A little prayer to the bowling gods, I think. She hits on the left side of the two pin, catching the four. The two knocks out the five. It looked good, but she didn't think it was going to make it there.
Oh, dear. You heard a big O, and that's because Leanne Barrette left a split.
Leanne Barrette right now is saying, I can't seem to get anything going or get anything right. She hit the pocket solidly in the first frame. She left a 9-pin, comes back, hit the pocket again, and leaves the swishing 7-10. Two bad breaks for Leanne.
So coming off a spare, Leanne Barrette has the second frame open and stands at 27, giving McMullen a 13-pin advantage.
This is Leanne's third television appearance here in 93. She's finished third. Three seems to be a number for her this year. She's finished third twice in the Claremore Classic and also the New Generations Classic.
But then slipped to fourth in Reno.
Trying for the light hit again. Seven pin stands. And she's talking to herself. You'll notice the big difference between these two players' game. With Leanne, that big hook ball is able to swing the ball out to the right, brings it way back, versus Debbie McMullen almost playing a very, very large point shot.
So a spare, an open frame, and a spare for Leanne Barrette. Debbie McMullen opened things up with a strike, her second frame. She bowled a six on the first shot, but then picked it up. Now she's in the third frame with a 13-pin edge.
The 1990 Rookie of the Year. Both of these players were Rookie of the Year. Leanne Barrette, 1987 Bowling Digest Rookie of the Year.
McMullen likes number 14. In 1992, she was Denver's Bowler of the Year. You can see the scoreboard. Strike, spare strike for McMullen.
And she's re-racking again on lane 13. She re-racked. That's what that little check mark in the next to the two, the second frame, meant. She will get another one. If she would request or would like any more, then she'll have to request another re-rack. And Paula Vedad, our tournament director, would therefore have to okay it.
Now, here's how they competed round by round, our top five. Take a look at Debbie McMullen at the bottom.
She made a big move after round one. Competition was very tight. Last night in the final position round game, Debbie McMullen was in fifth spot. Anne-Marie Dugan was in sixth, but sixth people could have made it into the top five. Debbie McMullen won that match against Anne-Marie. Therefore, she made it into the telecast.
It's interesting, I said we're on lanes 13 and 14, and Leanne Barrette on this lane has an average of 255. So she's had some success on the 13-14 combination, but doesn't seem to be rolling her way tonight.
No, they do not seem to be falling. This end of the house, the low end of the house, you could swing the ball a little bit more, had better carry. The high end of the house, you really had to point it a little bit more. Like I said, they seem to be a little bit tighter. Leanne Barrett's not getting
the carry at all. I mean, she has hit the pocket three times and three times pretty solid and has not got a strike yet.
Three spares for Leanne Barrette with an open frame in the second. Three strikes for Debbie McMullen.
Leanne Barrette playing around the 12th board, swinging out to right around the 8th or 9th board. So her ball is basically going left to right, whereas Debbie McMullen is going right to left. You can see the difference. There's the swing. That ball's not going to make it back.
What adjustment should she make?
Well, she's tried to tighten up her line on lane 14. When she did, she kept the ball right between the 12th board and like the 9th board, and she left the ring in 10. Lane 13, she tried to give it a little bit more room, trying to think there might be some dry boards out there to get the ball to really hook back into the pocket. That wasn't the case. There was out of bounds. She hit it, and it sailed right on her.
Oh. Another open frame for Barrette.
It really appears that the straighter players are definitely going to dominate tonight. They're going to be able to get the ball to the pocket more consistently and carry better.
Now, we said Barrette had averaged on these lanes 255. McMullen's average is 226.
See there, Debbie McMullen getting a little bit ahead of the ball. She actually has pretty late timing anyway. As you can see here, she's going to get to the line way ahead of the ball and then pull the ball through. Basic four-step approach, but already she's here on her fourth step and then just really pulls the ball through. Extremely late timing.
So McMullen has not left an open frame yet. Leanne Barrette has two. Two spares and the rest are strikes after five frames with Debbie McMullen. Eight times she's bowled 300. Oh, it moved but wouldn't drop.
Debbie going straight down the boards, but she needs to actually point the ball up a little bit to the left. She does not throw much of a hook, pretty straight tight bowler, so the ball is not going to make a break into the pocket for her. She therefore has to stand a little farther right, point it a little more to the left.
And she easily picks that up and enjoys a 35-pin advantage over Leanne Barrette. Can Leanne rally back? Stay with us. It's a 34-pin advantage now for Debbie McMullen. When we last left you, she had just had the spare in the sixth frame. She has an open frame in the seventh. For Leanne Barrette, she spared in the sixth and left an open frame in the seventh. So Debbie McMullen is up now in the eighth frame. She is on lane 13.
And for those of you that were wondering maybe what those W's mean on the scoreboard, they mean a washout. Basically, the pins are separated, but the head pin is standing. So both players have left a washout. Again, the lanes are tighter. They were unable to get the ball up to the head pin. Right now, Leanne Barrette could put something together. She could shoot 187. Should force Debbie to continue to mark, but Leanne is just having a difficult time. She really came out and hit the pocket good there for the first four frames, but nothing went. Then she started to search a little bit and got into trouble. You can see there, she's finished third in two of the events so far this year. She finished third here in two previous years, in 1990 and 1991.
In 1990, she bowled back-to-back 300s, but that's not the story tonight. She's still looking for her first strike as she rolls into the ninth frame, and she's just struggling tonight. It's just not happening for Leanne Barrette. And I think searching has given way to almost aggravation. You can almost see in her eyes. She's very frustrated right now.
Well, it's difficult when you are hitting the pocket and things aren't falling, and then you do start searching and everything goes against you. Everything goes wrong. She'll... Yes, looking forward to going to the U.S. Open next week.
That brought some noise from the crowd.
And hands raised by Leanne. And you mentioned the look of frustration. This is like, yes, are all 10 going to go? It's my first strike of the night.
Finally.
Right.
Relief.
Debbie McMullen just saws the rack in that shot.
Now, you talked about her late release. Is it better than a quick release? Is that just her style, or should she correct something here?
Well, her late timing, that, you know, that's her natural game. And most professionals are late to some extent, maybe not as late as Debbie, but this is the way she bowls. And as you know, bowling is such a natural game that people really have to perfect what they do naturally. But professionals tend to be a little bit late. That way they can plant at the line. They can plant their left foot for a right-hander, right foot for a left-hander, and they're able to hit the ball, release the ball with a good, crisp release. If they're early with their timing, the ball tends to just float off their hand, and the ball gets ahead of them. So most professionals you'll see plant at the line and then whip the ball through. That's late timing. Debbie McMullen, a strike right here, will give her an even 200 game. Leanne Barrette, though, could only strike out for 177.
So Debbie McMullen will move up the ladder. We are going to step aside, but when we come back, Alita Sill will be here with our spring tour tip.
25333 now.
So the right-hander out of Denver, Colorado, Debbie McMullen, easily handles Leanne Barrette, 196 to 175. She'll face Kim Couture, but right now let's look at the tip. The LPBT Spring Tour tip is brought to you by Ebonite International, where advanced technology has striking results.
Hi, I'm Alita Sill, a member of the Ebonite Pro Staff. Tonight I'd like to talk to you about converting your corner pin spares. For the left-hander, the 7-pin, and for the right-hander, the 10-pin. The most common mistake I see in amateur bowlers is that they use the same hand position for both their strike ball and their spare ball. For the strike ball, you need to use a very strong hand position. But for your spare, converting your 7-pins, you don't need that at all. You need a weak hand position. So the way to do this is move your feet all the way over to the right of the approach, point your feet towards the 7-pin, break your wrist into a weak hand position, draw an imaginary line right between the third and fourth arrow, and throw the ball along that line. So remember, move your feet all the way over to the right of the approach, point your feet towards the pin, break your wrist into a weak hand position, throw the ball on that imaginary line. If you do this, I think you'll become more consistent in shooting your corner pin spares.
Oh, she makes it look so easy. Well, will it be easy for Debbie McMullen to handle Kim Couture? We'll have to see. Her average was 216, Debbie McMullen. She didn't do that in the first match. She'll need it in the second. It's East Windsor Connect Season's Bowl in Alexandria, Louisiana. You're looking at Debbie McMullen. She's moved up the stepladder finals to face the number 3 seed, Kim Couture. Now, Debbie McMullen was well below her average in her first match. Let's see if she can pick things up in the second.
And not a good opening shot. As she shakes her head, she comes back. She leaves the 6-7. She'll want to try to hit on the right side of the 6-pin, slide it into the 7 by Alita Sill. Tries to break that wrist. Go a little straighter at the 6-pin so it doesn't curve as much. Oh, oh nice. Nice try.
Great effort. Now you're looking at Kim Couture. So we take another look. Great job.
If it could have just got a little farther to the right, the 6-pin would have just flown into the 7. It just missed it.
Kim Couture's husband is also a pro bowler. His name is Pete, and she starts things off with a bang here at the Four Seasons.
Kim Couture using all of the approach, a five-step approach. You can see here, very nice game. Not much of a backswing, long slide, and look at the follow-through. She has worked very hard at her game, perfecting it. And another player to re-rack on lane 13.
You'll notice she is wearing the red pin indicating AIDS awareness. I asked her if there was a particular charity or something that she was involved with, and she said no, but she has a very close friend who is HIV positive and would like very much to see a cure, as we all would.
Kim Couture playing much farther outside than Debbie and Leanne. Kim can actually hook the ball a little bit, but nothing like Leanne Barrett. Kim's bowled very well so far in 93. She's entered all nine events. She has cashed in all nine events. And recently, her and her husband Pete relocated to Titusville, Florida. I know Pete is operating a pro shop down there.
She converts to spare. This is her first TV finals, though, of the year. The 1991 Ebonite Rookie of the Year. Now Debbie McMullen steps back up, looking for her first career title. In 1989, she was inducted into the Colorado Sportswoman Hall of Fame.
Just saw a lane break down between 13 and 14. Pretty even. Once again, the ball coming up a little bit light. If she is not in good time, and we've talked about her timing all night, the late timing, but if she gets even a little bit faster with her feet, the ball sails off to the right. She is unable to point the ball as much. She ends up leaving a washout. So usually when you're way ahead of the ball, you're too fast with your feet, your ball tends to sail off to the right. It's critical for Debbie to be right in time with the late timing that she has. That makes sense, right? In time with the late timing.
If you're going to be late, you have to be on time late.
I think we're confusing them. Debbie McMullen's mother, Peg, I know, has been instrumental in her bowling career and coaching her. Peg used to bowl herself out on the ladies' tour. Looking for the light wall shot, but leaves herself with 4-7. See there, she's calculating her moves on the approach. Players talk to themselves, basically trying to figure out what type of moves to make, whether they move their feet on the approach or whether they move their target or whether they do both.
And that's her first spare of the match. Two open frames and a spare in the third as Kim Couture steps up. Now Couture and McMullen had played with Kim Couture prevailing 207 to 196 in match play. Strikes in a spare for Kim Couture.
I watched Kim practice a little bit. She said the outside seemed to be hooking a little bit more for her, sort of like the morning blocks. She said, I did move out to around the first two boards. I could get the ball to hook back. And here she has a pretty nice shot right where she's playing now. She's right around the first arrow, basically down and in. Actually, she's a little farther out on that.
Oh.
She is out about the 2-3 board. All business this lady is right here.
Little relief there. Well, when she gets a double, now she's meditating.
When you're playing that far outside, it's always relief just to keep it out of the channel. Oh, looking... Oh, I think it was a fast rack. Yeah.
Oh, too bad it came down. Yeah, it might have
fallen at the last minute.
Yeah,
I think it would have.
Look, it's still wobbling. Look at that.
Debbie's high game this week, 258. Low game, 179. Her average on the TV pair was 226, but Kim's average was 242.
...34-pin deficit for Debbie McMullen.
Both of these players looking to win that first title.
The open, the washout, two spares. Let's see if she can get in the groove now. That's fun to see the ladies get their first title. We got to see Jill Albrecht do that a couple of weeks ago, and we got to see Jan Schmidt win her first Queens tournament. It adds an air of excitement when it's the first time.
Yes, it does. And here, a half pocket hit, six pin just lays in the channel. Does not knock out the 10.
Three spares for Debbie McMullen in her last three outings. Let's see what Kim Couture can do. She's on a double. It has a 35-pin advantage. There you see her numbers on these very same lanes, 242.5.
Kim's only made one previous television appearance. That came in the Hammer Midwest Open in Rockford in the fall of 92. She lost to Carol Giannotti, 240-156. So that was not a very pleasurable experience for Kim. I know she has learned from that, and it's obvious because she has come out with some great opening shots here tonight.
You know, Lita Sill gave us a good tip on how to pick up this very spare. Looks like she followed the textbook on that one.
Well, something Kim does, she takes off her wristband. Now, that wristband helps to give her that stronger wrist, as Alita was mentioning. By taking off the wristband, she has a weaker wrist. Therefore, she's able to throw the ball a little straighter at the 10 pin so it doesn't hook by it. Maybe a close-up at her wristband, her hand position. Again, another 10 pin. High game, 299, has not yet bowled a sanctioned 300 game.
I think that hurts worse to have a 299 as opposed to a 292 or 295.
It's really difficult, Leander, to get a 292, though.
All right, we're going to step aside. Kim Couture very much in control. 33 pins up on Debbie McMullen. And while we were away, here's what happened on the scoreboard. Kim Couture now has three spares. Debbie McMullen did strike in the sixth, picking up a spare in the seventh. And now Kim Couture is up in the eighth frame.
Kim Couture with a commanding lead in this match. 31 pins. You see her playing that extreme outside line. Gets great revolutions on the ball. Really hits the ball nicely.
You know, right before we went to commercial break, we had mentioned the 299 factor. That's her high game. And you said you have a friend in Texas who's bowled a lot of 300s and actually tried to bowl a 292. You said it's very difficult to bowl a 292.
It's very difficult to get two pins out. Matter of fact, as far as I know, at least it was 8 or 9 years ago, a 292 was the only 290 type score that had not been shot. 291, 93, 94, 95, all the way to 299, but never a 292.
A little interesting tidbit there.
Debbie McMullen trying to pick up the 245. Debbie's employed as the house pro at Celebrity Bowl in Denver. She also works with the Professional Bowlers Camp. She is a staff member there, and she'll be coaching throughout the summer at the various camps. Great way to pick up some great, great advice from some top professional bowlers is to attend one of the camps. If you're really serious about bowling, serious about your games, look into the Professional Bowlers Camps.
And for the second time tonight, she clears the deck and still finds herself way behind Kim Couture.
really critical shot there in the ninth frame. That set herself up for the 10th. She can shoot a possible 192. Kim Couture right now shooting at a 2-0 pace.
And here are the Pro-Am winners in the senior division, Earl Terrett. In the women's division, Trudy Crate. And in the men's division, Kirk Capello. The Pro-Am winners here at Four Seasons at the Alexandria Louisiana Open.
And that last strike basically locked up the match for Kim Couture. She just needs a 6 pins. She has a 44-pin lead.
Did better than that.
Really throwing the ball nice. Appears to have a good shot to the pocket. Nice angle, and she's carrying, and that's the big key here. We saw Leanne Barrette get to the pocket well the first half of the game, but was unable to carry, unable to get all 10 down. Debbie McMullen kind of breezed through that. Never has really looked like she was lined up. But this lady has a nice shot to the pocket.
Nice strong finish here by Kim Couture.
Debbie McMullen will have to take this in stride, finishes fourth, and goes on to the U.S. Open next week.
Garland, Texas.
Showplace Lane.
Well, it doesn't matter, but the crowd ooing anyway as she finishes with a 232.
Nice place to leave that if you're going to leave it.
Right.
Leave it on a fill shot when it doesn't need it.
So Kim Couture over Debbie McMullen. And we'll show you the rest of the top 24. But first, these messages.
The LPGA Oldsmobile Classic. Live coverage begins June 4th on Prime Network.
The Bud Light LPBT Spring Tour is being brought to you by Faball Enterprises, maker of hammer bowling balls and the finest of bowling apparel, bags, and accessories. Visit your local pro shop with a complete line of hammer products. And by Ebonite International, where advanced technology has striking results. And the score of our second match saw Kim Couture defeat Debbie McMullen. So Debbie McMullen, who started at number 5, finishes in 4th with a 232-172 final. Kim Couture advances. So how did the rest of the top 24 finish up? Well, it's being brought to you by the Hoinke Classic, an amateur bowling event for men and women paying over $2 million each year for 10 consecutive years. For information on the Hoinke Classic, call 1-800-543-4010. Finishing 6th is Jean Nakarado of Tacoma, Washington. She was 3rd last week in the Queens WIBC title.
And in 7th, Anne-Marie Dugan, now from Edmond, Oklahoma. She's won 2 titles this year.
Number 8, amateur Lori Soto of Dearborn, Michigan. First LPBT tournament this year.
And Nancy Johnson, the 1992 Oklahoma State Hall of Fame inductee.
No relation is Tish Johnson of Panorama City, California, the 1992 Woman Bowler and Lin Shu Player of the Year.
And in 11th, amateur Eleanor Korzek, a collegiate from West Texas State.
Number 12, Robin Romeo of Van Nuys, California, 1989 Lin Shu Player of the Year.
And a winner here on the Spring Tour in 13th, Jill Albright.
Number 14 is Carolyn Dorn of Linden, New Jersey, a one-time pro titleist in the doubles with Lisa Wagner.
And in 15th, a good friend of mine, Lori Nichols. She finished 2nd here in 1991.
Number 16, Alita Sill. She did the tip this week. She finished 5th here in 1991.
And a contender for Rookie of the Year, Paula Stinsky from Appleton, Wisconsin.
Also in contention for Rookie of the Year is this lady, number 18, Kathy Doran.
And Dawn Thorkelson in 19th. She was an inductee into the Minneapolis Bowling Hall of Fame in 1992.
Number 20 is Dee Dee Davidson of San Jose, California. She was the 1985 Rookie of the Year.
And in 21, Carol Giannotti, the 1992 Player of the Year runner-up. She won 4 of her 6 pro titles in that year.
Out of Daytona Beach, it's Laura Moriarty, a 2-time Florida State Queens champion.
Another amateur in the field, Kathy McBride from Longview, Texas.
Finishing 24th is Chris McCune of Munster, Indiana. She replaced Donna Adamek, who withdrew due to injury.
And our alternate, Linda Byerly, replaced Chris McCune.
And we're going to step aside, but when we come back, Kim Couture steps up the ladder to face Lisa Wagner. Stay with us. Exciting bowling just ahead here on Prime.
Call now and send check a money order to the address on your screen.
It's a battle of Floridians as Lisa Wagner takes on Kim Couture. Hello again, I'm Leanne Verratti along with Leila Wagner, and we've now moved to our third match as the number 3 seed Kim Couture faces the number 2 seed Lisa Wagner. In case you're just joining us, Kim Couture just defeated Debbie McMullen to advance to this match.
And a lane breakdown. Once again, 13-14 playing very similar for Kim as she comes up light, swishing wall shot, carries. Here she is very lined up to the pocket. We'll have to see if Lisa Wagner can get as lined up. Now, Lisa Wagner will play similar to the same angle as Kim, but Lisa throws the ball so much harder. It'll be interesting to see her ball reaction.
We should call her the colorful Lisa Wagner. I should also like to add that she is wearing a microphone, so we'll be able to hear her comments.
Lisa playing a very different line than Kim Couture.
That's a good guess.
A good guess, as she said. A look at her game. She takes that four-step approach. Large first step. Very high backswing. Plants, like I talked about, the late timing, and then hits the ball. Now, she's playing around the 12th board, more of the angle that Leanne Barrette was playing, but she will keep the ball straighter in line, more like from 12, once again, to 9 or 8, not sending the ball out too far to the right. She knows she will not be able to get it back.
Well, we heard her say, oops.
Whoops, she tugged that ball inside. That ball staying right around the third arrow, 13th board. She has to trust it a little bit, but not too much. I'm really surprised she is not playing farther out with Kim Couture's ball reaction that she is getting out. Lisa Wagner usually dominates when there is a condition that lends itself to an outside line. Apparently, she felt that this line that she was playing here, she was getting a better reaction in practice. Something that I've noticed with the new balls on the market, the reactive resin balls, they hit the oil, they tend to slide. This is something that has happened when she shot that 4-7. She hit the lane conditioner in the center of the lane. The ball went into a slide, did not hook.
There you see in the background, Pat Burns, the director of sports marketing for Anheuser-Busch.
And coming up just a little bit light, leaving herself with just the 2-pin. It's nice to see Pat again here this week.
And here's Steve Economist, district sales manager for AB.
And the people at Anheuser-Busch have been wonderful to us.
And there's James Jones, Sr. He's a director of marketing for Southwest Beverage.
Kim Couture trying to convert the 2-pin. Kim, 25 years old, been on tour 3 years now. He's really starting to mature as a professional player. She's making more and more finals, as I mentioned earlier. She has cashed in 9 of the 9 events.
Now, in match play, she lost to Lisa Wagner 218 to 195.
But you know something, as a player, I know that you don't even think about that. Yes. You probably don't even remember it. After 24 games of match play, 42 games of the tournament itself, it's a completely new day. Watch the hit here. It's a little bit high. The head pin goes up against the wall, hits the 7, and the 4-pin just wiggles.
It's funny, on the TV pair, Kim Couture is at 242. Well, Lisa Wagner is at 216.
And that's their averages for the two games that they bowled in match play on this pair.
Again, it's a new day. Conditions have changed, but it is somewhat of a bellwether.
Exactly, as we saw Leanne Barrette struggle on this pair earlier tonight. She had averaged 255 previously on lane 13 and 14. Lanes 13 and 14. Lisa Wagner, once again, trying to strike on the right-handed lane. Back for her. And I mentioned, if she sends the ball too far to the right, it will not come back. She has to stay perfect in the line she's playing. And what she just said was, that was a nice shot.
Sarcastically,
exactly. And we saw Leanne Barrette really struggle with this line right around the second arrow. But this is something, I watched them bowl last night, and they were killing the place. They were knocking down pins like you wouldn't believe from the same line.
Second time she has left an open frame.
On spares, and that can hurt. You're missing spares in your one-game match. You're just giving away pins to your opponent.
There you see on the scoreboard, Kim Couture strikes spares sparely, so Wagner strike open.
If those two open-opens would have been spare, the match is even.
Keep it slow.
Keep it slow, she said.
Apparently she needs to tell herself to keep it slow.
I throw a lot of strikes.
She said, I hope I throw a lot of strikes because her spare shooting tonight is very good. This is perfect. The ball stays right on line, right around the 12th board, solid in the pocket. She wanted to keep it slow.
Relief and joy simultaneously.
She has a tendency to throw it extremely hard when she gets pumped up. Therefore, the ball would not have time to get into a good roll and break into the pocket. So she really needs to concentrate on keeping her ball speed down. Kim Couture, on the other hand, throws the ball much slower than Lisa Wagner. Much different style. That hit high. And as I mentioned, slower. That one was real slow as she also pulled it inside her mark. Ball coming out right on the nose. Almost up to 4, 6, 7, 10. But as you can see there, the 6-10 falls at the last minute.
Call that a courtesy fall. It was
big break.
Yeah. Strike, spare. The first three frames for Kim Couture.
Kim Couture had suffered some back problems earlier this week. I know she was treated by Dr. DeQueen, a chiropractor that was on hand for the players. The synthetic lanes we bowled on this week, also the synthetic approaches, sometimes can be a little tacky and also a little slippery, and they can cause you to jar a nerve or two in your back. And Kim Couture, that's her husband, Kim Couture, another re-rack.
And here we see the proprietors of Four Seasons Bowl, Jim and Jane Sumrow. Very nice people.
And Pete Couture, Kim's husband, also a member of the PBA. Not able to be here. Almost a solid 9-pin. We saw Leanne Barrette leave it in her opening shot in the first match. Now, normally the ball takes out the 9-pin, but here it's driving so hard. Watch it hit left of the 9. But the head pin flies off the wall and takes it. The messenger.
Slow in the beginning. One at a time.
Talking to the ball, she says stop, hold pocket. Now Lisa Wagner's telling herself, slow in the beginning, one step at a time. She has been working on her game in this past year. She went back to her basics. A good friend of hers tore her game apart, Ted Thompson in Florida, and he said, hey Lisa, your basics are all off, and she's gone back to revamping her whole style. So she has to concentrate really on that first step, on her push away, keeping it slow.
She has elected to re-rack. Now, how does this one look any better?
Well, from the angle we see, it appears the pins are all on spot here. But it really does appear the players are having problems with the racks on lane 13, since that is the only rack that they have been taking their re-racks on.
So it's turkey time for Lisa Wagner. Three strikes in a row. We'll be back with the rest of match number three. Stay with us here as bowling continues on Prime.
Plus 323 shipping and handling to Blood, Sweat, and Glory, Grand Central Station, P.O. Box 5294, Department B-471, New York, New York, 10163.
While we were away, Kim Couture stepped up in the sixth frame and sent this one right into the pocket for her second strike. And then in the seventh frame, she got her third strike in a row. Then Lisa Wagner stepped up in the seventh frame and got all but one, leaving number seven. She does make the spare. Now that brings us up to the eighth frame, where once again, she leaves one standing.
Lisa Wagner coming up a little bit light last time. Left is leaving the two pin. As you can see here, the match got even there around the fifth frame, but Lisa Wagner now trails by 21.
Those two open frames coming back to haunt her as Kim Couture is clearing the deck.
Oh, my. She pulled that one a little farther to the left and it was going to hook, but once again it just went into a slide. Lisa Wagner very disgruntled at leaving that seven pin in the seventh frame. It was a light shot hit, but the pins came flying off the wall, jumped all over the seven pin and didn't fall, and that would have just kept her right into this match. But now she trails by 22. Kim Couture working on three strikes.
Yeah. And now working on four.
Kim's sponsor, Lee Leventis. And it's always nice getting a sponsor. I think this is something that's happened quite recently. You can see there, look at Paula Bidette, our tournament director, O'Kane.
A re-rack.
That third re-rack. Players are allowed two.
Now Paula comes down there and takes a look from her perspective and says, yes, there's something out of line?
Right. Well, at times the player might do it just for timing, to regroup or to throw off the pace of the match. But other times it's really the pins are off spot.
As a rule, when the pins are off spot, is it the entire 10 that are off spot or is it just one or two?
No, usually it's just one or two. Kim Couture right now, commanding lead, 32 pins going in the ninth frame. Five in a row. Lisa Wagner, best possible game right now she could shoot is 215. Mm-hmm. She would force Kim Couture to mark in the 10th. She has to have this one. It's all over.
Oh no.
Six pin slaps the 10, but the 10 does not go.
Look at that, it's still going down there.
It's teasing me, it's still wiggling.
Watch this, the six pin hits the 10, and 10 pin just wiggles. Well, this match is basically over. Kim Couture will go on to meet our top seed, Patty Ann. Lisa Wagner really bowled extremely well all week. She was in the top five every round. She came out, she led the first two rounds of qualifying. She dropped to fourth, moved back up to second, took the lead yesterday morning, and last night her and Patty Ann rolled off for the number one position, and she lost that match to Patty Ann. Patty Ann therefore became our top seed. But Lisa Wagner was really the most consistent of all five finalists, staying up there the whole week.
Well, something else I haven't told you is who won the new car. Remember, Leanne Barrett and Patty Ann had both bowled 300 games, and they had a bowl-off earlier today, and I still haven't told you who won that brand-new Toyota Supra.
We'll wait till Patty Ann gets out, or maybe to divulge that one.
And a little tug of the ear from Kim. who she was saying hello to. Probably Pete, huh?
We could start a story here and say it's to somebody else, but...
No, she's
that wouldn't be responsible. Wouldn't be responsible journalism. Oh, another open frame for Lisa Wagner as she finishes with a 193, and Kim Couture moves into the championship match to face Patty Ann. Stay with us here at the Four Seasons. This Alexandria, Louisiana recap is brought to you by Faball Enterprises, maker of Hammer bowling balls and the finest of bowling apparel, bags, and accessories. Visit your local pro shop for the complete line of Hammer products. In the first match, Debbie McMullen over Leanne Barrett, 196 to 175. In match number two, Debbie McMullen was shut down by Kim Couture, 232 to 172. And like fine wine, Kim Couture improved with age. She easily handled Lisa Wagner, 246 to 193. And here's what put the nail in Lisa's coffin.
Kim Couture up in the eighth frame. She's currently leading by 22. She's working on three strikes, throws this one just beautifully like she did all of the others. And she forced Lisa Wagner to get up in the ninth and strike. She was not able to do so.
So now it's Kim Couture against Patty Ann. Plus we'll have the results of who won the car when they had their 300-pin bowl-off. Stay with us here in Alexandria, Louisiana. We are back, and it is time for the championship match. Number three seed Kim Couture against top seed Patty Ann. And it's Patty Ann who will be up first. This is her first time on TV in 1993. Her first time in the top 24 in 1993 in a TV event.
That's actually her sixth all-time career television appearance. And as she opens up, she comes in a little high, leaves herself with a four pin. As we mentioned in the open, she was a professional at one time, gave up that status, turned amateur, and her total years on tour have accumulated to six. And she's planning to return to the tour here in the fall.
Now, she's not really from Mayagüez, Puerto Rico. That's where she lives now. She's from the Midwest.
From Illinois, and she did ask me to say hi to all her friends and family back in Illinois. That's where her family's from. And she's originally from, yes. And she also wanted to say hi to all her friends in Puerto Rico. Kim Couture's lane break down here. Once again, she has a nice shot on both lanes. 13, she had four strikes. 14, three, that was last game. Beautiful, she is just lined up to the pocket. And once again, average on the television pair. She dominated the field here, 243. Two for her two games of match play. Patty Ann, though, only averaged 177. And Kim is keeping up to that average pace.
I know earlier I told you that Leanne Barrett and Patty Ann had both bowled 300 games, and a local dealer here provided a brand-new Toyota Supra. Guess who got the car keys? Patty Ann. She won in the roll-off, and there you see her getting in the car. It's a T-top. It was a pretty car. I looked at it. It was right here at the bowling center, the Four Seasons. So I don't know how she's going to drive it back to Puerto Rico, but that's a problem I wouldn't mind having.
True, true. And another strike for Kim Couture. She is after her first professional title. She is determined. She is throwing the ball great. Ann has accomplished just about everything you can in amateur bowling.
That car she won was provided by All-Star Toyota here in Alexandria, Louisiana.
A very unique style, very basic, very small steps, push four-step, push away, slides and actually releases the ball right at the foul line, then follows through, does not really rub the ball up a lot, but the results are the same, a strike.
I need to con. There was something was on 14 right now. There's a
pin missing.
A pin missing on lane 14 now. Actually, there was a pin missing in the previous frame on lane 14. She was missing an 8 pin. In regulation, she should. They're going to go on. She's not going to reshoot the shot.
Interesting, because she...
Very interesting, because they
She knocked down 9 pins then, right?
Well, no. Actually, she needs to reshoot the rack, because it was not... there were not 10 pins
right,
up.
Right, she shot down 9
she
pins.
She shot down 9 pins.
Here, we have the luxury of a replay.
That's right. This is the shot on lane 14. Let's take a look at the pins. Can you see an A pin? There is no A pin in that rack. That is an illegal shot. She needs to reshoot the rack. We have it on instant replay.
We'll see if we can get Paula Vidad to give us an interpretation
of the rule and find out what's going on. Apparently, Paula Vidad did not see it. They really did need to call Patty Ann back and have her reshoot that.
And Paula Vidad is saying that she will reshoot. We just got that confirmation. I believe they just told Patty Ann that. They're going to do it after. They're looking at Paula Vidad.
And trying not to disrupt the pace, which is good. Kim Couture is working on strikes. They don't want to disrupt the pace.
And oh, is she working on the strikes? That's her fourth in a row. And now Patty Ann's shot will be erased, and she'll have to reshoot on number 14. And she's looking a little bit in disbelief. And I'm sure the spectators are probably wondering what is about to happen. She's stepping up on 13. Let's see what Paula advises her to do. No. Now they are verifying where it is she needs to...
She and Patty Ann trying to regroup. I don't recall this happening in any prior telecast. As Patty Ann is now reshooting it. She's struck again.
So it becomes a moot point. She struck out with 9 pins. She struck out with 10 pins. And it's a 10-pin strikeout that will count. And now there's some confusion as to which lane she should be in.
She is going to step up again on lane 14. She'll resume play. As scheduled, I should say.
Now, here's what she's going to try and win if Kim Couture doesn't stop her, and that's this beautiful inscribed gold bracelet. That is the trophy, as it were, from the Alexandria Open.
Oh, throwing the ball a little slow that time. Ball coming up through the nose. Leaves herself with the... Actually got a pretty good break by only leaving the 4-7-9.
Well, I'll tell you, Patty Ann's rhythm may have been disrupted by
the
less than smooth way this was handled.
I definitely think so. It had not been happened in the past. Paula Vidad has only been acting tournament director for this year. It's something that, you know, whenever something happens the first time, you learn by it.
Now Patty Ann is questioning Paula Vidad, and
Patty Ann is definitely upset. She does not understand what's going on. Paula Vidad actually doesn't understand either. Somebody
right
has
now
mentioned
some confusion as to what happened. Paula Vidad was not able to see the replay, which showed definitively that there was a pin missing. We're going to step aside while they sort this out. We'll be back, and we'll clarify the situation here on the Ladies Pro Bowlers Tour. Don't go away. More action coming from the Four Seasons Bowl.
You're about to see...
happened here at the Four Seasons is back in the second frame for Patty Ann, she threw a strike, but there were only nine pins. She'd already bowled her third frame, and that validated the second frame score. Therefore, the strike that she bowled as a provisional does not count. The seven, the split, counts as her shot in the fourth frame, and that's where we stand now. She is bowling in the fifth frame on lane 13, her first shot being a nine, and we'll see if she can convert the spare.
And Kim Couture, trying to keep her momentum and keep her pace up, has opened up with the first four strikes.
Was a pretty heated debate, and it all stemmed over whether or not a provisional shot should have indeed been taken. The interpretation was no, it should not have been taken because she had already bowled the next frame. And once you bowl the next frame, whether it's you bowling your following frame or your opponent, that seals the score.
Kim Couture up in the fifth frame, trying to put five strikes together, going after her first title, and she does. And something we should mention, any player wearing a Brunswick shirt throwing a Brunswick ball is entitled to a $100,000 prize for shooting a 300 game. The first time this spring that we have been in the position, Kim Couture with the first five could win that bonus.
Well, Kim Couture has really done a remarkable job maintaining her composure. It was quite a heated debate between the tournament director and Patty Ann. We jinxed her with the 300.
And just as you said that, and just as I mentioned the 300, she hit very much inside her mark. She was closer to the second arrow that time. She has been playing outside the first arrow. She pulled the ball inside the second arrow. She left herself with a 4, 6, 7, 10. She'll go for the pin count. She'll go for two pins.
And that she does.
Patty Ann trying also to regain her composure for the second half of this game. Needs to start putting something together here. Is working on a spare in the fifth. Is trailing by 31 pins. And a beautiful strike in the sixth frame. Patty Ann also just sets the ball very short, right in front of the foul line, a slight point to the pocket. You'll notice she keeps her shoulders very close to the line, very parallel to the foul line.
Well, she certainly has picked up a lot of the sympathy vote. Kim Couture and Patty Ann have met earlier in match play, with Kim Couture prevailing 256 to 192.
Watch the light hit here. Five pin almost doesn't go, but it does. And then just at the last minute, takes out the seven. Her reaction, knows it's a double, knows she just cut her deficit down to 21. And Kim Couture pick up the pace again. Oh, my.
Oh! She'll take it
out the 2-8. That really is the first break she has gotten all night. She has basically been in the pocket all of her shots that she has struck on. She really has not thrown any nosedives or any Brooklyn shots. She's been making good, clean, crisp shots. But that one came up very light. Head pin off the wall, trips the 2-8.
She needed to do it again, yeah. Didn't happen.
Again, she's inside quite a bit on lane 13. I think when she replays this tape, she'll be able to see exactly the line, the difference that she has right now is that she's playing in 13 and 14. She's not quite trusting it. You know, that arm swing gets a little tight. You're going for your first title. Even though she has the lead, it's tough to get loose.
Thank you.
Nice conversion. Yeah. Difficult with that sleeper sitting behind the two pin. But she really converted that nicely.
When I was a little kid, I was on a bowling team. We called ourselves the sleepers.
Right now, Patty Ann working on a double, looking for the third strike in a row, eighth frame. Should cut Kim's lead to only 11. High. Real high. You almost knew that when it left her hand. She pulled the ball way inside target again, the 4-6. Normally the ball goes down the lane before it starts to move in the pocket. That ball was going right towards the head pin the minute it left her hand. And I know Kim Couture is sighing with a breath of relief. She's not watching her opponent. Just concentrating on one shot at a time. Patty Ann now trailing by 35. She could shoot a possible 207. Kim Couture, though, is shooting at a 220 pace.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Well, that strike there, Kim Couture is holding her own destiny in her hands. She must mark in either the ninth or tenth frame to lock up this match.
She's working on a spare from the eighth frame.
Let that one way out.
Way outside.
Oh, my. But she leaves herself with only the two pin. As she looked up, that could have been disaster. She trusted it, though. She didn't pull it, but looking at the scoreboard, trying to calculate quickly in her head exactly what she needs. She picks this up and stays behind the foul line. She picks this up, should need nine pins in the 10th frame to win her first title. She's been a member of the tour for 3 years.
Converts the spare. It's interesting, we were talking about her maybe bowling a 300 a little bit earlier, and she's never bowled one. It would have been nice had she achieved two goals in one outing.
That's right.
300 game and her first career title.
Well, this is her only her second television appearance.
So we'll see if she can pick up nine here, and that would close a proverbial door on Patty Ann.
The 1991 Ebonite and Bowling Digest Rookie of the Year. Can she get nine?
She does.
I don't know if she realizes it yet. She's still looking at the scoreboard. She's taking her wristband off again. That tip from Alita Sill.
You want the weaker wrist to pick up that spare.
Mm-hmm.
And it works. So we're going to step aside. We'll be back with a recap of what's happening here at the Four Seasons. And a chat with Kim Couture, the winner here at the Alexandria Open.
200, call now.
The Bud Light LPBT Spring Tour has been brought to you by Bud Light. If you want great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down, make it a Bud Light. And by Brunswick, home of the winningest pro on tour, the Brunswick Rhino Pro. And there's the face of a champion, Kim Couture, winning her first title, the final score, 217-206. And standing next to me is James Jones Sr. He is the director of marketing for Southwest Beverage with the presentation of the Bud Light Trophy.
Kim, on behalf of Anheuser-Busch and the Bud Light brand, congratulations on winning the Alexandria Open.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Bud Light, the Shimmicks, for hosting our tournament this week. They did a great job. Dr. Dufresne, the chiropractor, who helped me out all week. It was great. And Lee Levent is my sponsor at home. Lee, we have some money coming.
Okay, now I'd like to introduce Jim Sumrall. He's a proprietor here at Four Seasons, and you're not kidding, you have some money coming.
Kim, it's a great pleasure to present you this check for winning the Louisiana, the Alexandria Louisiana Championship.
Thank you. And next we have Tom Schimmick. And he has another trophy to present. He is the general manager here at Four Seasons.
Kim, we did something a little different this week, and we want to present you with this gold bracelet from Four Seasons on your first tournament victory on the LPBT Tour. Congratulations, you bowled great this week.
Thank you.
Now, Kim, we have some questions for you because you did a fine job. This is your first tournament win. It was certainly exciting. Give us your impressions.
Well, Patty Ann bowled great all week. A lot of controversy in that last match. I think it comes with the Couture name. My husband Pete's bowled in a lot of controversial matches on the PBA Tour. So I think it comes with a name. I'm not sure.
Yeah?
The left lane, it appeared you had a little problems with. What happened?
Well, we had quite a little break there for a few frames, and I think it's just started to hook a little more, the evaporation from the lights. But just in enough time, I adjusted.
All right, so Kim Couture from the number three spot finishes number one, winning the Alexandria Louisiana Open. So long, everyone, from Alexandria. This has been a presentation of Bud Sports in association with Prime Network.